Hello everyone, good evening. Welcome to Rehabilitation Sciences YouTube channel. We are here again with another good session today, second session, thoracic surgery insertion and physiotherapy management. And we have with us Dr. Preeti. Dr. Preeti, we would like to have your consent for making your lecture live on YouTube, ma'am.
I give my consent to make
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. And Dr. Sagun, you can start the session from this.
Thank you, Dharam sir. Good evening, everybody. Welcome to the Rehabilitation Sciences. Today, we have got the privilege to have Dr. Preeti Saini with us. She is gold medalist in amputee cardiopulmonary from the Maharishi Markandeshwar University, Mulana. And currently, she is also pursuing her PhD from Punjabi University. Ma'am is working as assistant professor in Manav Rachna University, Faridabad, from last 6 years. Since 2015, she is teaching in Manav Rachna. She has got a lot of publication in Scopus Index Journal. And along with this, she has got a special interest in hyperinflation, ACVT, pulmonary rehabilitation, and the exercise prescription. We welcome you, Dr. Preeti, on the Rehabilitation Science Group. Thank you for coming on this channel.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Dr. Preeti Saini. I heartily thank the Rehabilitation Group for inviting me to give this lecture. And I'm also thankful to Rehabilitation Group as they are bringing all the physiotherapists to a common platform. Thanks, Rehab Group. Thanks, Shagun sir. Thank Dharam sir. Thank Harpreet sir for making a common platform for all of the physiotherapists to learn various techniques which will be helpful to all of us in the future. So with this, I start my topic, that is thoracic surgery, incision and physiotherapy management. Basically, thoracic surgery means, basically first we start with incision. What do you understand by incision? Incision is basically a surgical wound introduced by a surgeon on the skin with the intention of gaining access to the chest cavity. When this wound is introduced in the thoracic area, then it is known as your thoracic incisions. Thoracic incisions basically are of two types, that is basically there are conventional incisions and there are modernized incisions. We are going to discuss it in the detail in further of my slides. First, I will start with why the thoracic surgery is basically indicated. What are basic indications for which thoracic surgeries are indicated? So first question which arises in the mind of a physiotherapist is, why should I run a thoracic surgery? Mujhe kyu pata hona chahiye ki mujhe thoracic surgery karni hai? Ya mujhe thoracic surgery ke baare mein kyu janna hai? When I am a physiotherapist, so why should I learn about thoracic surgeries? I am concerned about thoracic surgery because post-operatively, when the patient comes to me, it is my duty to make the patient like it is pre to the surgery. So that is the responsibility of a physiotherapist, and that is the reason we are studying the thoracic surgery. We don't want to be a surgeon, but we want that we should know each and every aspect, each and every muscle which is cut during the thoracic surgeries, so as I can reduce the post-op complications for the patient and I can make the life of the patient as possible and also increase the quality of the life. So basically the indications for thoracic surgery, basic indications are when the person is suffering from a lung cancer. So that is the basic and major reason due to which the thoracic surgeries are performed. But that is not only the reason. There can other reasons, like if the person is suffering from any type of heart problems, sometimes then also there is the requirement of the heart surgery, that is thoracic surgeries. Like the person is suffering from a congenital heart defect. That is the major reason where the thoracic surgeries are required. If there is any problems of esophageal cancers, in that cases also there will be the requirement of thoracic surgeries. Even if the patient have any injury on the chest, and to overcome that injury, sometimes thoracic surgeries are required. And a major and a surprising reason of thoracic surgery is pneumothorax. So why do we perform a surgery in a pneumothorax? basically sometimes there is a reason or there is a condition known as tension pneumothorax. In tension pneumothorax, basically there is a sudden increase in the pressure of your chest, and that due to that there can be a sudden collapse of the patient. There can be pressure on your heart, there can be pressure on your lungs, so it can lead to a sudden collapse of the patient. And to avoid that, we basically make a incision inside the lung so as we can convert a pneumothorax or a pneumothorax to an open pneumothorax. Even for the management of COPDs also, we require thoracic surgery. In the advanced cases of COPDs, like in COPD basically means it is an umbrella term which comprises of your bronchitis and emphysemas. In emphysemas, there is sudden increase in the length as well as inflation of your lung. So in that cases also thoracic surgeries are required. Thoracic surgeries are sometimes required in the cases of tuberculosis. Why thoracic surgeries are required in tuberculosis? Because it is an infectious form of disease and it leads to a failure of lungs sometimes. It can even lead to respiratory failures and it can even lead to infection to the other healthy lung. So as to avoid that infections or that infectious condition, sometimes thoracic surgeries are required. Even when the person is having any mass inside the mediastinal area, to recognize that mass and to do biopsy for that particular area, there is requirement of thoracic surgeries and to make the thoracic incision inside your lung. Sometimes there are fracture of ribs, and to even that to suture that fractures or even to stabilize your ribs and even to stabilize your costochondral junction, thoracic surgeries are required. Sometimes thoracic surgeries are also an emergency measure, or emergency thoracotomy is required when the patient is suffering from any type of chest hemorrhage. So basically these are the indications due to which we do thoracic surgeries. Now the basic that I already told you, we can classify the incision in two types, that is conventional incision and video assisted thoracic incision. So conventional incision, dono mein farak kya hai basically? Conventional incision basically, they are more of incision which have a large muscle to cut, large area to involve. But the modernized incisions are basically in which the area cut is less, secondly the area which is exposed is less, the muscle which is cut is less, and therefore the recovery is very fast. So let's first discuss the conventional incision, which is done in the cases of your thorax. That is, first one is your posterior lateral thoracotomy. Posterior lateral thoracotomy means, let us see in this picture, we are in thoracotomy incision. The incision start at the level of the third thoracic vertebra. It run along the border of your scapula, then it extend and it goes to the anterior angle of costal margin, or goes to the costal margin. It usually in this we incise the bed of the fifth and sixth rib. It is most commonly used when surgeon have to do pneumonectomy and lobectomy. Then why it is important for a physiotherapist to learn this incision? Because we have to work on the muscles, and we should know which muscles are cut during this incision so that we can properly work on the patient in the post rehab phase. Example, the muscle cut during this incision is starting from here, it is your trapezius which is cut, then going down it is your latissimus dorsi which is cut, then going further down it is your rhomboids which is cut, and going further anteriorly it is your serratus which is cut, and corresponding intercostal muscles are cut. So due to this there can be problems like your shoulder can freeze, your person can have a scoliotic posture, person can have a bending toward one side, and even other problems can arise due to intercostal muscle cut. That is, the chest is not going to expand properly. So that is the reason why should physiotherapist know why this incision is opted. Because if the person has undergone posterior lateral thoracotomy, the physiotherapist should be clear that trapezius is cut, I have to work on trapezius. latissimus dorsi is cut, so I have to recover the function of latissimus dorsi. If the rhomboid is cut, I have to focus on the function of serratus interior. Intercostal are cut, so I have to focus on the function of intercostal. That is the reason it is important for the physiotherapist also to know the thoracic incision and to work on it. So this is the reference. The reference I have taken from the thoracic journal, and they say that posterolateral thoracotomy is the most widely used incision, but nowadays it has been replaced by a video assisted incision, and popularly this is used for the cases that is pneumonectomy and lobectomy. And it is usually under pneumonectomy and lobectomy, that means it is also taken care when your lung cancer is there. Then next is your anterolateral thoracotomy. Ab anterolateral thoracotomy or posterolateral thoracotomy mein kya farak hai? Anterolateral thoracotomy and posterolateral. Abhi humne posterolateral ki baat kari, humne baat kiya ke posterolateral incision is starting from your vertebra 3 and it is going around the border of your scapula, whereas anterolateral jo incision hai, that is starting from your 5th costal cartilage. It starts at the level of 5th costal cartilage, It goes beneath your breast to posterior axillary line. Now, how can I trace my posterior axillary line? It is very easy to trace a posterior axillary line. You hold your one fold of axilla, you hold your second fold of axilla. When you hold anterior fold of axilla, there is a line which goes from the midline of that fold, that is known as anterior axillary line. And there is a posterior fold of axilla, and there is a line which passes through that particular midline of that particular fold, that is posterior axillary line. And when I hold both anterior and posterior axillary line, or anterior fold and posterior fold, and I trace a midpoint from it, the line passes through midpoint is known as your mid axillary line. So basically in anterior thoracotomy, I start with 5th costal cartilage, then I go beneath the breast and I proceed till posterior axillary line. And the muscle cut, as it is the anterior incision, the muscle basically which is incised is your pectoralis major, your pectoralis minus, and intercostal muscles. It is basically used in the cases of cardiac surgeries and pleurotomies. When I want to approach my pleura, this is the best incision that can be undertaken. Then, but why are we not taking this incision as a main incision? It is not taken as the main incision, as in cases of female, it is very difficult to take this incision, as anterior thoracotomy is the incision in which we go beneath the breast, and it is very difficult to in the female patient, as breast tissue is hanging on it and it is very painful for them. So it is not, that is the reason we try to opt for posterolateral incision. Then next one is your clamshell thoracotomy. Then what is the difference between your clamshell thoracotomy and anterolateral thoracotomy is that when anterolateral thoracotomy incision is done on both the side, then it is known as your clamshell incision. It is basically an extension of your left anterolateral thoracotomy. It is done when I want a better exposure of my hilum. When I want to then that time I prefer clamshell thoracotomy. Then the same muscle are cut, but in this incision, in clamshell thoracotomy, it is a both side of muscle which are excised, whereas in anterolateral thoracotomy, it is only one side muscle which is excised. That is, in this, the muscle excised are pectoralis major again, pectoralis minor again, and intercostal of both sides. Whereas in anterolateral, it is of unilateral side. It is basically an anterolateral incision when done on both sides is known as clamshell thoracotomy. It is a very good incision to be used when I want to go for hilum, the descending aorta, but it is not a very good incision when I want to approach the trachea and great vessels, because they come beneath this, so it is not very good incision to be followed if I want to approach my superior mediastinum or trachea. Then third incision is my median sternotomy incision. Very, very common incision, usually used in all the COBGs. All COBGs are basically, or all cardiac surgeries are basically done by this incision. A very good advantage of this incision is that there is no muscle cut during this incision. It is only the aponeurosis of pectoralis major which is cut during median sternotomy incision. This is the incision which starts from suprasternal notch and it extends 3 centimeters below the ziphy sternum. Very important, because CABG, basically we use wire to manage our sternum bone, and there is no muscle cut, so person can mobilize very easily. So advantage, or basically it is used in lung reduction surgeries, it is used in cardiac surgeries, it is used in when I want to approach bilaterally my pleura, at that time I use median sternotomy incision. These all pictures I have taken from Tidy's 15th edition book. Then next incision is my axillary thoracotomy. Why I prefer axillary thoracotomy? What is the advantage of this incision over other incisions is, firstly, this incision is near your armpit. It is just near the armpit. It is the approach through the third intercostal space, and it is very common when I want to treat the pneumothorax. At that time, this incision is very good incision, because this is the best incision in which pleura can be approached. Even some surgeries of the heart and lung other than your pneumothorax can be approached by this incision. Then next is your, as I already told you, that there are two categories of incision, conventional incision and video assisted thoracoscopic incision. Conventional, we have already learned that there are 4 conventional incisions, that is anterolateral, posterolateral, axillary and median sternotomy. These are the 4 major incisions which we conventionally use, and there are various muscles which are cut during these incisions. Then next we come to your modern incisions. This is a modernized incision and it is known as your video assisted thoracoscopic incision. The advantage of this incision is that for this incision, there is very small hole and there is a very small muscle cut. So there is a reduction in your healing time. Basically, in this, 3 holes are created, in which there is introduction of an endoscope through one hole, there is introduction of a cutting device through one hole, and there is introduction of a video camera through. In this incision, basically there is no need to cut a muscle, expose the structures, and then basically visualizing. There is a camera which go inside, and the person and the surgeon is able to visualize it on the screen and cut through a small hole. That's why it is very, very, very easy. And there is an advantage that there is a reduce in size of the hole, muscle cut are very less, and even there is a reduced pain and very less impact on respiratory mechanics. So nowadays we try to use this video assisted thoracoscopic incision and muscle sparing incisions, as we want to reduce the healing time to minimum. Then next is various operations which we do on our thoracic area or lungs is pneumonectomy. What is pneumonectomy? Pneumonectomy means removal of whole of the lung. Okay? Removal of whole lung is your pneumonectomy. But when we remove whole of your lung, that means one lung. Dono lung nahi hata sakte hum. It is only one lung which we remove. And indication, why we want to remove the lung? Why we don't want to save the lung? Why shouldn't we have saved the lung? Because it is a very important structure, we should have saved it. In the indication for removal of lung is basically when the person is suffering from any malignant tumors. That is the basic reason in which we have to remove the whole lung, so as to save the other lung and body from metastasis. That is the major reason for which we perform pneumonectomies. the second reason for which we perform the pneumonectomy, if there is a severe injury to the lung, at that time also we have to remove the lung so as to reduce the hemorrhage and bleeding inside the lung. And the other reason, which is very common in India, as it is an infection which is commonly leading to the lung damage, is pulmonary tuberculosis. Pulmonary tuberculosis is leading to the damage of the whole lung, and it is even making us viable that both of our lungs is going into infection. That is the reason we are doing pneumonectomy in the cases where there is a widespread pulmonary tuberculosis in the lung. Then next thing for which we do the pneumonectomy is the fungal infection of the lung. Fungal infection of the lung means when the person have any kind of infection, any fungal infection which is spreading to any part, there can be even pneumonias which can spread due to fungus, or there can be chlamydia infections which can occur in the lung, due to which there can be an episode of pneumonectomy. Bronchiectasis is the dilatation, that is a permanent dilatation of your dilatation of your bronchioles and bronchi. That is the reason that there is increase in your residual volume, and there is person have a very, very, very difficult breathing. So to reduce that, we perform pneumonectomy in that cases. Even there are some congenital lung diseases in which we have to perform pneumonectomies. Like sometimes the lung does not develop properly. Sometimes the lung develop properly, but there are it is hyperinflated in these cases. And sometimes, like in cystic fibrosis, there is a problem inside your lung. At that time also sometimes we have to remove the lung. In bronchial, when the person have a destroyed lung or metastatic lung, at that time also we have to remove the lung. Then what are the risk factors which basically occurs after your pneumonectomy? You have performed pneumonectomy, but all risk factors which are going to be there after your pneumonectomy, first is your respiratory failure. Why the lung is going into respiratory failure? We have removed one lung. Okay. Now the pressure is whole and soul is on other lung. And there is some underlying cause which is already present inside the patient. That is like due to COPD, I have to remove the lung. So it can lead to a heavy demand on other lung and leading to respiratory failures. And even there is a high metabolic demand which is created during after pneumonectomies, that can be the risk factor for respiratory failure. Sometimes even blood clots can be there in pneumonectomy. When we remove the lung, we tie the bronchus, but sometimes there is a leak from that particular areas, and it will lead to blood clots in that particular area, and that is also a complication for pneumonectomy. There can be complications which are infectious complication and non-infectious complication. Infectious complications are like pneumonia. Sometimes there can be infections which can lead to pneumonia inside the lung. That is also a complication for pneumonectomy. Sometimes there are abnormal bleedings and abnormal heart rhythms which are associated with pneumonectomies. At that time also we try to see whether pneumonectomy can, whether what to do or what all techniques we can use. Like in respiratory failures, various physiotherapy techniques can work. In pneumonias, in chronic stage of pneumonias, when there are fibrosis, then also various techniques of physiotherapy can work. This is a picture in which we can demonstrate that how the complete lung is removed. This is your diseased lung and it is removed. This phenomena is known as pneumonectomy. And this is an X-ray which is showing a pneumonectomy lung. This is a aired lung and this is a removed lung. And this is a X-ray presentation which is visible after you have removed the lung. This is your pneumonectomy X-ray. And this is taken from a site known as Radiopedia. Then second is your lobectomy. Lobectomy is the surgery to remove the lobes of the lung. Why we want to do pneumonectomy and why we want to do lobectomy? Basic difference between two procedures. Why the surgeon opt for pneumonectomy and why the surgeon opt for lobectomy is the area or the problem which is or area the problem is found in how much part of your lung. Suppose it is confined only to a lobe. So we can remove that lobe and rest of the lung is healthy. But suppose the problem is widespread, there is a metastasis, there is no particular area which can be removed and it can lead that now the my lung is healthy. There is no such area present inside my lung. So at that time I have to go for pneumonectomy. But sometimes infection is confined to a particular lobe. At that time I can go for lobectomy. And that is the reason, or that is the basic method for choice of the surgeries. Lobectomy is the surgery to remove one or two lobes. Basically, our lung is divided into three and two lobes. In right side, there are three lobes. In the left side, there are two lobes. Lobectomy is done when the problem is found in just a part of the lung. Jab sirf ek hi particular part ya ek hi particular lobe mein aapka problem rahega, at that time we can perform lobectomy. But when it is not confined to a particular area, we are seeing that the infection is in the middle lobe also, in the lower lobe also, at that time we have to perform pneumonectomy. Basically, if I come to indications for lobectomy, so the basic indications for lobectomy is tuberculosis. वहाँ पे भी हमने न्यूमोनेक्टमी में भी पढ़ा था ट्यूबरक्लोसिस, यहाँ पे भी हम ट्यूबरक्लोसिस पढ़ रहे हैं. देन हाउ वी कम टू आर डिसीजन वेदर टू डू लोबेक्टमी और न्यूमोनेक्टमी. बेसिकली इफ द ऑन गोइंग इन्फेक्शन इज क्रॉनिक एंड इट इज नॉट रीअकरिंग अगैन एंड अगैन, इट हैज बीन कन्फाइंड टू अ पर्टिकुलर एरिया. नाउ इट इज ओनली अ एरिया विच इज built inside your lung, and that can be removed and further the lung can be saved, so we can go for lobectomy. But when the infection is acute and it is involving whole of the lung, it is damaging whole of the lung, at that time only and only pneumonectomy can be performed. And second indication for lobectomy is your lung abscess. What is lung abscess? Basically, lung abscess is the area of pus that may be formed inside the lung. The abscess does not go with antibiotic because this area is the area which make itself confined from the lung. There is no blood circulation going to that area. It is only infection which is spreading inside that particular abscess. To remove that abscess, because it is, I already told you that it is the isolated area inside the lung. At that particular, if we remove that particular area or that particular lobe, whole of our lung is normal. So in that cases also we perform lobectomy. Then next is our emphysemas. Emphysema is basically hyperinflation. It is a type of COPD in which hyperinflation of the lung is there, and there is loss of the elastin tissue. Usually your lung is very elastic, it is like a balloon. Every time we deflate it, it inflates, it deflates. But this elastin fiber is lost in the cases of emphysemas. You are not able to breathe, you are not, because the lung is already in an expanded position, you cannot expand it further. So in that cases also, we sometimes shapen up the lung, we sometimes remove the lobe of a lung so as the hyperinflated position of the lung can be changed. So in that cases also, we prefer to go for lobectomy. In the cases of benign tumors in which your growth is not cancerous and there is no danger of it spreading toward the other normal tissue of the lung, in that cases also we go for lobectomy. Even fungal infections, in cases of fungal infection also, in which the fungal infection is confined to a particular area of the lung, in that cases we perform lobectomy. Then what all other problems that is associated with our lobectomy, that means what our post-operative complication that arises after lobectomy is infection. Infection means that some there I already told you the infection can be of two types. There can be a infection which is acute and there can be infection which is chronic. Sometime a chronic infection which is already inside the body, due to reducing immunity, it goes up and there is a further infection which is due to your lobectomies. And even sometime there is area which is formed inside the lung or pleural cavity, which is leading to basically, which is basically leading to a picture that there is a segment formed inside the lung, and this segment is basically a area in which air cannot enter and air cannot exit. It is basically making the area of infection inside the lung, and this is the basic reason due to which we perform lobectomies. There, the very important complication of lobectomy is bronchopulmonary fistula. Bronchopulmonary fistula is an area in which there forms an opening inside the lung and pleura, and this occurs after 8 to 10 days of the surgery, and it is very important complication as air basically leaks from the bronchus from the area from which we have removed the lobe, and the continuously the air is leaking out of it. Then this is an X-ray. This is your one lobe removal. The area of infection is confined here only, and we have removed this lobe only, whereas in pneumonectomy we have removed this whole lung. So this is the difference between lobectomy and a pneumonectomy. This is an X-ray stating lobectomy. In this, the lower lobe of the left side of the lung is removed. So this is the absence of the lower lobe in your X-ray. Then next come the segmental resection and a wedge resection. Very, very important. A confusion always arises in these two terms. In some books, it is given that segmental resection and wedge resection are the same thing, but it is not same. According to surgeons, according to Belly and Love, the basic surgery books, it has been stated that segmental resection and wedge resection have a minor fine line difference in between them. In segmental resection, the segmental resection is basically the removal of bronchopulmonary segment. It can be anatomical bronchopulmonary segment, it can be a physiological bronchopulmonary segment, and when your segment of the lobe is removed with its circulation or with its bronchopulmonary segment, then it is known as your segmental resection. Whereas in wedge resection, only it is not following any type of bronchopulmonary distribution. It is only a undefined or ill-defined part of the lung which is removed, in which the infection is there, and that is known as your wedge resection. And this is the major difference which we come across in various surgery. This is a diagram which is showing this is the area of wedge resection in which there is no, it is an ill-defined area. We have a lesion over this area, so we remove this area. This is a wedge resection. Whereas in segmental resection, along with the segment of lobe, we remove the segmental artery, that is the bronchopulmonary segment which is supplying this particular area along with this bronchopulmonary segment. This is third picture is showing lobectomy. This is the removal of whole lobe of the lung. And this fourth picture is showing pneumonectomy, which is basically showing that whole of your lung is removed. This picture I have taken from Mayo Foundation and I gave a proper regard for it. Then next is your lung volume reduction surgeries. Lung volume reduction surgeries. First, what is the need of these surgeries? Kyun karni hai lung volume reduction? Why should we reduce the lung volume? Kya reasons hai isko karne ke liye? Lung volume reduction surgeries are basically the procedure designed to improve the respiratory function. When there is bullous, when there is emphysema, I already told you that emphysema, there is hyperinflated lung. Hyperinflated lung means there is a flattened diaphragm. When the lung increase in size, what will happen to the diaphragm? Diaphragm will get flattened. And when the diaphragm will get flattened, what will happen to the length of the diaphragm? Length of the diaphragm. That means from, if I measure it from contraction to relaxation stage, that is reduced. That means the area from which it goes to relaxed position and to contractile position, that particular area is reduced. That means the force generated due to diaphragm contraction, that is reduced. So in that cases, when there is flattened diaphragm due to hyperinflated lung, in that particular cases, we perform lung volume reduction. That means we shape the remaining, we shape the lung, we cut the lung, we shape it, we remove the hyperinflated areas, and we do the expansion of the healthy lung. So as our flattened diaphragm, that goes to a normal position and a normal length tension relationship should be followed. And it will basically help in reducing the symptoms of dyspnea. And after a proper physiotherapy, the person goes to a normal volume after given lung reduction surgery. But if there is a need of a proper physiotherapy and a pulmonary rehab program, so as the person should have a normal respiratory function. Then other operations which are done on your lung is pleurectomy and decortication. These are not the lung surgeries. These are basically pleural surgeries, but we consider it in thoracic surgeries because they also play a very important role in the volumes and capacities. And when we perform pulmonary rehab, we have to consider all these surgeries, that is pleurectomy and decortication. First, what do you mean by pleurectomy? Pleurotomy basically means, pleurectomy is the procedure removing of your parietal layer of pleura from the chest wall where it is adherent. Usually what happens, there are two layers of your pleura. First is your parietal pleura and second is your visceral pleura. Parietal pleura, that is a pleura which is attached to your chest wall, whereas a visceral pleura is the pleura which is attached to your lung. And there is a cavity inside, that is your pleural cavity, in which continuously a fluid is flowing, that is your pleural fluid. But sometime what happens due to fibrosis or due to infection, the fluid inside your pleural cavity that goes that thickens, and basically these layers or these areas become roughened and they become adherent. And due to this adherent, when the patient breathes and when there is expansion, patient feels a pain. In these particular cases, when the patient is feeling the pain, at that time, sometimes we excise the parietal layer of the pleura to make it raw, and so that the adherent area of the pleura can be removed, excised, and ligated. This is known as your pleurotomy. Then is your decortication surgeries. Decortication surgeries basically is carried out following chronic empyema. Empyema means there is a pus inside your cavity. When this pus basically when this pus become fibrous, at that particular time there is a problem, and we basically remove a particular fibrous area of that pleura and we re-expand the lung. This type of surgery is known as your decortication surgeries. Then is your complication of surgeries. But all complication occur after we have discussed it along with the surgeries also. But this is the overall complication which can occur with any type of surgery, whether it will be a pneumonectomy, whether it will be a lobectomy, whether it will be a lung expansion, lung reduction surgeries. Any type of surgery have a common complications, like there can be a sputum retention and infection. Why there will be a sputum retention? We are going to discuss it one by one, why there are sputum retention, infection. Basically, when we give anesthesia to the patient, and even due to cut off your intercostal, muscles, this is the area where there is maximum drainage and there are maximum number of nerve fibers. This is the reason the patient is feeling a very high pain after your pulmonary surgeries. In that case, patient will not allow you to expand the chest. The patient is not even going to take a deep breath. The patient is not going to take a deep inspiration. There are few areas in which there is no air entering and there is no escape of the air. That is the reason that there will be a sputum retention and infection after pulmonary surgeries, which is quite common. And it is an important complication for cardiac pulmonary surgery. Then second is your atelectasis. Atelectasis means there is a collapse of a small lobar area after the pulmonary surgery. It is quite common because, as I already told you, that there is not proper expansion which is going on inside your lung. That is the reason the lower areas of the lung that or even alveoli in which air is not entering, that goes into a collapse. And there are third important complication of your pulmonary surgery is pneumothorax. As I already told you that there are sometimes chances that the area from which we have removed the lung or the area from which we have removed a particular lobe, that bronchus is continuously leaking all the time. And there is a connection which is formed inside your pleura and your bronchi. At that particular time, there is this arise as a complication, and there are chances that there can be air inside your lung, that is known as your pneumothorax. Then next one is your pleural effusion. There are chances that there can be a pleural effusion as the person is not expanding the lung properly, and there is a continuous drainage of the fluid from the area where we have sutured after surgery, and that is continuously draining. And if we have not put the chest drain properly, or if we have removed it priorly, that can be the reason of the pleural effusion. Even there can be surgical emphysema. Surgical emphysema means if we have injured the lung, and due to injury of the lung, there are hyperinflation of the lung that can be leading to the surgical emphysema. There can be even respiratory failures and circulatory failures. Respiratory failures, I have told you that in the cases of pneumonectomy, when the pressure on one lung is increasing furthermore, that can lead to pulmonary surgeries. Even hemorrhage can arise due to a continuous blood leakage from bronchopulmonary stump. There can be hemorrhage. And as associated with other surgeries, there can be deep vein thrombosis, there can be pulmonary embolism, and there can be other complications like infection, there can be stroke, there can be damage to recurrent laryngeal nerve, phrenic nerve, there can be loss of joint ranges, and there can be a postural changes. Then next is, what is chest tube drainage? Why we are going to discuss this here? Because in every type of lung surgery, there is chest drain which is put in. So as there are basically two intercostal drains which are put after your surgery. One is at the apex of the pleural cavity, and second is at the base of the pleural cavity. This is basically when there is bleeding, that is removed with the help of the chest tube, and a tube which is at the apex of the pleural cavity that allow the air drainage, so as the air should not enter your pleural cavity and lead to a pneumothorax. The patient who have undergone pneumonectomy have a single drain, whereas the patient who has undergone any other lung surgeries have two drains. In this, the drainage passes from the pleural cavity in a sterile bottle. Let me show you bottle first. So these are basically bottle for your chest drainage. It can be one compartment like this, or it can be a three compartmental bottle. Usually the preferred bottle is this one. In this, this is from your patient, and this is toward the atmosphere. The pipe which is coming from the patient is dipped always inside the water, so as the air cannot enter the chest cavity. And this is to maintain the atmospheric pressure. There are sometimes a third pipe which can be to the suction pump. If we want to suck more of the blood or more of the air, at that time, sometimes we attach a suction pump to this particular pipe, and we can put a suction onto it, and there can be a proper drainage for it. And this is the movement of the air column, which is associated with inspiration and expiration. When we have put the chest strain in the patient, we should always check this movement, that is a cyclic movement. when the patient is performing inspiration, at that time there is negative pressure inside the lung, and as there is negative pressure, it pulls the water up. That means that the column of water rises inside the body. And as the patient performs expiration, at that time the negative pressure inside the thorax goes down. That leads to the decline in the water column inside the lung. So this swing should always be maintained with inspiration and expiration. If this swing is not maintained, either there is no air inside your cavity, or there is any blockage inside the, there is any blockage which is inside the lung. The physiotherapist have a very important role in draining your chest tube, as we should take care that when we are making the patient to breathe, do the breathing exercise, we should properly support these deep chest tube drains. And secondly, we should take care that your chest tube, your drainage bottle should not be above the level of your lung, because it will make the air and blood to re-enter the chest cavity. This is the basic precaution we should take care, because if we keep it up, the air and the drainage water will go inside, so there will be a problem. And during breathing, we should keep a hand on to chest, or we should properly support the drainage tube, and then we should perform the exercises. Then physiotherapy part after thoracic surgeries, or physiotherapy with thoracic surgery, can be divided into three phases. Basically, that is your preoperative phase, postoperative phase, and assessment phase. Why preoperative physiotherapy is important? I have worked with many a hospital, but I haven't seen a preoperative physiotherapy going on for the cases of pneumonectomy. I have worked at least 5 years with one of the major brand names, but preoperative physiotherapy is lacking in our chest. Even in cardiac surgeries also. So what is the need? Doesn't it have any need? Koi zarurat hi nahi hai preoperative physiotherapy ki. Agar zarurat nahi hai, toh fir kyun karna hai? There is a need. There is a need of preoperative physiotherapy. Kya need hai basically? We want to evaluate the patient. We want to assess the patient. Example, a patient come to you who is already suffering from a COPD, who is already suffering as the patient is undergoing a respiratory surgery, that itself indicates that the person might be suffering from one or other form of the respiratory diseases. So we should always and always assess the patient preoperatively. If we haven't assessed the patient preoperatively, then there are chances that the patient is not going to recover properly in the post-op phase. Secondly, we should teach the control and correct breathing to the patient. Why it is important in preoperative phase? Because after post-op, there is a pain which is associated with your breathing. At that time, if you want to teach a control or correct breathing, patient is not going to cooperate with you. Okay, so that is the reason that we should teach the patient preoperatively all these exercises, so as patient should be aware of a correct method of breathing and should not suffer from any type of complications postoperatively. The patient should also be aware of the posture which can be there after postoperatively. We should teach the patient how to correct the posture time to time, so as the postural scoliosis, which is associated and most important complication of the surgery, that can be prevented very easily if preoperative physiotherapy is done. Then if the patient should be taught postoperative cough, because at that time, as already we are knowing from our previous slides, that there is a very high incidence of pain associated with your lobectomies and pneumonectomies. So we should teach the patient cuff techniques prior to the surgery. Even removal of the secretions can be done priorly if it is present. And thirdly, the patient will gain the confidence in physiotherapy if it is being taught preoperatively and will cooperate with you postoperatively if it is being a part of preoperative protocol. So your preoperative physiotherapy can be basically according to various references I have found out and various books which are basically quoting, there should be three readings or three visits of the physiotherapist in preoperative sessions. And what all things we should concentrate in preoperative physiotherapy is examining, observing, and drainage. What we are going to examine? We are going to examine any discomfort, any different type of breathing, any type of sputum, or any other different type of complaints which are associated with the patient. But we are going to observe, we are going to observe breathing pattern kaisa hai patient ka. Kaise breathing pattern se patient jo hai wo breathe kar raha hai. Are he or she is using our accessory muscles? Why we are bothered about it? We are bothered about it because post-operatively, if preoperatively he is using accessory muscles so much, so we should correct it priorly because post-operatively it will cause much more problems for the patient. That is the reason we should observe the patient, observe the breathing pattern. It should be corrected priorly and then we should proceed for a surgery. Even shoulder ROM ranges can be checked because if already the patient is having a restricted shoulder and restricted posture, so it will create a problem for the patient. That is the reason preoperative physiotherapy play a very, very important role. And if the bronchial secretions are present, we should work on it prior to going for a surgery. Like we have to teach the patient ACVT techniques. We should go for postural drainage and the bronchial drainage can be done. Even diaphragmatic and apical breathing can be taught to the patient. Cuffing and huffing techniques should be, which we have taught, should be assessed on consecutive days so as the patient can do it effectively after surgeries. Patient should be taught how to move out of the bed, how to go in the bed, how to sit on the chair, how to do crook lying. These all should be taught to the patient preoperatively so as the post-operative journey of the patient should be very, very smooth. Then let's come to very important part, that is the role of the physiotherapy in post-operative part of thoracic surgery. Firstly, we should know what all problems that going to arise after thoracic surgery. We should make a problem list. जब हम problem list बनाएंगे तभी तो हमें पता चलेगा ना कि हमें क्या करना है, ठीक है? तो the problem list after thoracic surgery is first patient positioning, improper patient position. As I already told you, there are tendency of the patient developing scoliosis. Why patient develops scoliosis? When the patient is not having any type of spinal problem, why the patient is going into a scoliosis? Because of the reason that when we put a thoracic incision on the patient's skin or the patient on the patient thorax, patient start bending on that side to give the relief to that particular area because there is a pain which arises when the patient start to stretch that area. Due to that, patient try to bend on that particular side, and when the patient try to bend on that particular side, it is basically leading to a dip shoulder, a dip pelvis, a scoliotic posture, and other deformities of positioning. Then second post-operative problem that arises is incisional pain or a chest drain pain. As I already told you, pneumonectomy and lobectomy, there are chest drains which are put to reduce the air and fluid and blood inside the cavity. That is the basic reason there are chest drain and incisional pain which is associated with the with this particular surgeries. And this is basically leading to the problem that the patient is not going to expand the chest and there will be a sputum retention. The patient is not going to expand the area where there are chest drain in. At that particular, the patient is not going to expand that particular part that is leading to atelectasis. So this is the major post-operative complication which arise, and that this is the major reason due to which it arise. Then is your ineffective cough. As I already told you, due to pain, patient is not going to cough properly. And if the patient is not going to cough properly, there is no proper intrathoracic pressure that is produced. There is no intra-abdominal pressure which is produced, and the secretions are going to accumulate in the lung only, as the cough is not effective. And as there is a reduction in the lobe, there is reduction in our lung, there are chances of reduced lung volumes. So post-operative complications are basically patient position can alter, patient can have incisional pain, patient can have an ineffective cough, patient can have a reduced volume, patient can have an impaired clearance, patient can have a frozen shoulder as the muscle of the shoulder are cut. There are chances of postural abnormalities. There are chances because there is a cut on latissimus dorsi, there are cut on the rhomboids. There are chances, even there are chances of chest tightness as there is a cut on the pectoralis major, there is cut on the pectoralis minor. That is the reason the patient is going to develop many complications after post-op surgery. So what a physiotherapist is going to do? Now let's see what a physiotherapist is going to do. First, the role of physiotherapist. We are not a doctor. We cannot prescribe an analgesic. We are not going to prescribe analgesic, but this doesn't mean that we are going to reduce the analgesia of the patient and we are going to reduce the role of analgesics. Hamare physiotherapy dene se patient ki painkillers band ho jayenge. That is not only the motive. Yes, physiotherapy basically reduces the surgical incisional pain, but that is not to replace your not to replace the narcotics and other drugs which is given. That is to reduce the, firstly to reduce the dosage, firstly to reduce the dose which is given, and with time to taper off that narcotics and to taper off that post-operative pain. So first, what happens when the patient is having pain? When the patient is having pain, it will interfere in the tendency of the patient to take a deep breath and even to cough effectively. The pain restricts the shoulder movement. I'm not going to do my shoulder movement. I'm not going to do my scapular movement if I am having pain in my intercostal area. So basically, the pain is going to do four things for me. It is going to reduce my scapular ROM. It is going to reduce my shoulder ROM. It is reducing my tendency to take the breath. It is reducing my tendency to cough. So basically, what all things we are going to do for the pain, let's see. First thing which we are going to do as a physiotherapist for the pain is the application of transcutaneous electrical nerve stimulation. What is the role of it and what is the dosage? Basically, it is stated by Kirai S. Saxena Taneja Shiravat that the role of transcutaneous stimulation in post-operative analgesia is very, very established. The tense application for 20 to 30 minutes every 3 hours at the interval on the day following your electrical current, there will be an effective reduction in the pain intensity. That means ki agar every 3 hours tum patient ko transcutaneous electrical nerve stimulation de rahe hain, so there is a great reduction in the dosage of analgesia which is required by the patient. And dosage kya deni hai? 20 to 30 minutes every 3 hours, 2 to 100 hertz. That is the dosage which is given in many of researches. And this is the established dose which I came to know from various studies which I have quoted in the reference. Then is your cryotherapy. What the second modality which we can use for reduction of the pain is cryotherapy. The major after major surgery, simply giving the ice pack on incision dressing is going to reduce the pain of the surgery, and there will be a remarkable reduction in the incisional pain if the patient has applied a cryotherapy after the surgery. So that is the reason we are basically going to reduce. The third thing which we are going to do for your pain is your wound support. What is wound support basically? As I told you that your patient is not going to do the exercise, or patient is not going to breathe properly because there is a pain at the level of the chest drain, there is pain at the level of the incision. That is the reason the patient is not going to expand the chest. So to prevent that, what we are going to do, the first thing a therapist can do, a second thing which a patient have to do. First method, the physiotherapist stand on the contralateral side, that means opposite to the side on which the incision is there. Suppose left incision is there, we should stand on right side. And we should stabilize anterior chest, that is the area where the incision is there, and posterior chest. Whether the incision is on anterior part and posterior part, we have to stabilize both anterior chest and posterior chest. And we will create a position like a bear hug hold, and then we are going to stabilize it firmly. And now the patient is going to exercise, and this will reduce the pain, and the patient is now going to expand the chest. So this is the third method of reducing the pain by physiotherapist. This can also be taught to the patient, in which the patient can use a pillow, the patient can use a cloth, the patient can use a pillow roll, the patient can use a towel roll, and it can put on the area of the drain, and it can put on the area of the incision, and it can support the incision, and then can perform any type of technique like huffing or chest extension. This is the picture how the patient can support, and physiotherapist support I have already told you. Then is your positioning. Then positioning, a very important thing. अभी तक हम सब पढ़ते आए थे एंड रिसर्चेस भी कोट करती आई थी, ग्रेविटी असिस्टेड पोजीशन करिए, वेंटिलेशन इंप्रूव हो जाएगा, ग्रेविटी असिस्टेड पोजीशन करिए, आपके सेक्रेशन इंप्रूव होंगे. बट न्यूअर रिसर्चेस हैव थ्रोन अ लाइट ऑन अदर फैक्ट्स लाइक द अपराइट पोजीशन हैव एन बेनिफिट टू इंक्रीज द डायफ्रामेटिक एक्सकर्शन, एंड देयर इज इम्प्रूवमेंट इन द वेंटिलेशन एंड गैस एक्सचेंज. अगर हम पेशेंट को फर्स्ट डे, जिस दिन पेशेंट का सर्जरी हुआ है, उसी दिन बिठाकर या अपराइट पोजीशन में एक्सरसाइज कराएंगे, एज कम्पेयर टू जो पेशेंट जो है वो लाइंग पोजीशन में कर रहा है, अगर हम दोनों के फंक्शनल्स को या पल्मोनरी कैपेसिटी को कंपेयर करेंगे, तो द पल्मोनरी कैपेसिटी ऑफ द पेशेंट हु इज इन द अपराइट पोजीशन विल बी मच मोर हायर देन द पेशेंट हु इज इन द लाइंग पोजीशन. So we should encourage that patient should lie in the position that is a very important. I have marked it in the red also. High sideline position on the operated side up should be a better choice for the surgeries other than pneumonectomy. But for pneumonectomy, we should always perform. In this, we have done that our non-operated side should be down and operated side should be up, but the reverse is true for your pneumonectomy, and it is supported by both of these researches that this position when opted will help in pulmonary function, will help in improving ventilation, will help in improving the gas exchange. Then is your positioning that will help in bronchial secretion removal. That is a modified postural drainage position can be used, because head down position we cannot use immediately after surgeries. It will produce a cardiovascular stress. So we should try to have a controlled position, and we will try that this position can be opted with time, but modified postural drainage position can be recommended even on the day of surgery. And these are the two researches which is basically suggesting that if a gravity assisted position is opted, then it will help in the secretion clearance better than those person in which this positions are not opted. That means a patient in supine lying and a patient in a gravity assisted position. The patient in gravity assisted position have a better control of better breathing than as compared to your other services. Then early mobilization and ambulation. Now the concept of early mobilization have evolved like a magic, because post-operative mobilization is basically leading for, conventionally it is thought that we should rest for a day after the surgery so that body can recover, so that body can remove the body can repair, but it is not true today, because early mobilization, early recovery, this is a concept given by European Society of Intensive Care Medicine statement. They state that the post-operative mobilization can change the patient position and patient's pulmonary function test. If the patient is sitting bedside, a patient sitting on a chair and a patient walking have a major pulmonary function difference. That is the reason we try to mobilize the patient as soon as possible. And this is the research which shows that early mobilization with the sitting on the bed for 3.5 hours after surgery, maintaining a sitting posture for 30 minutes should lead to a better recovery of pulmonary function than a person who is on conventional mode. So this is the research which favor this point that early mobilization should be done. But during doing the mobilization, one should keep in mind that the cardiopulmonary aspect and the cardiopulmonary condition of the patient and even vital should be stable for mobilizing the patient. The organ perfusion should be very good prior to ambulating the patient. The patient's all drainage and all drain should be checked, and dislodgement or even mobilization of these things can be there, and even aspiration can be there. So these can be checked during the mobilization technique. Adequate analgesia should be given prior to mobilization so as the patient can cooperate during walking. And even if there is any type of hypotension, that means if the systolic BP drop by 20 or diastolic BP drop more than 10, then the mobilization should be put on a bit hold, otherwise it can be started with the 0 day. A graduated walking program can be started. The patient can be allowed to have a stair climbing even after 3 days of the surgery. If the patient on low risk can allowed on 3rd day, and patient even on high risk can be allowed 4th to 5th day if the vitals are stable. Then next is your lung expansion maneuver. Lung expansion maneuver after thoracic surgery include following point, that is first deep breathing exercises. Deep breathing exercises are basically the large and sustained exercises to increase in transpulmonary pressure to improve the ventilation and oxygenation. The prescribed amount of deep breathing, very important as it is taught by researchers, various researchers I have put after this, because deep breathing exercises prescribed post-operatively give and reference of 5 deep breaths with 3 second end inspiratory hold every waking hour. हर घंटे बाद आपने जितनी देर patient जाग रहा है उसको 5 breaths करानी है every hour, and for there should be 3 seconds of end inspiratory hold. Then is your thoracic expansion exercises. Thoracic expansion exercises also play a very important role in after thoracic surgery, as there are chances of atelectasis. So it can be inspiration and there can be a inspiratory hold that is leading to thoracic expansion. And thoracic expansion exercises preferably done in a position that is side lying or high side lying with operated side on the top and the hand on the back of the head. This is the best position in which thoracic expansion exercises can be done after your pneumonectomy and low back. This can facilitate the lung extension. That means the high sideline, as proved by research, is the best position in which the thoracic expansion exercises can be done. And it basically opens up the collaterals. Then next is your deep diaphragmatic breathing. Deep diaphragmatic breathing is the procedure in which we perform. Deep diaphragmatic breathing can be done in sitting, it can be done in upright position with posterior pelvic tilting. The patient is asked to relax the upper chest, breathe in from the nose, try to make his abdomen swell, expand it, and then gently exhale it. If the patient is using a accessory muscle, so we should first inhibit the accessory muscle by excessively using it. And the mechanism known as the contract relax technique can be there. And after that, we can go for the deep diaphragmatic breathing. Then deep diaphragmatic breathing after thoracic surgery can be accompanied by deep diaphragmatic breathing with arm and trunk movement. In this, we do the deep breathing along with arm flexion, arm abduction. Then is your trunk flexion away from the operated side during inhalation, and we return to the normal position or starting position during exhalation. So this is the technique. This is the diagram which is showing how to do the exercises with your arm movement. That is when we are going to take a breath, and along with the breath we are going to move our shoulders. During inhalation we are going to do, that is our trunk flexion. And during exhalation, we are going to go for the normal starting position. Then is incentive spirometry. That is basically, it gives the visual feedback. Spirometry, incentive spirometer can be of two types. It can be a flow spirometer. It can be a volume spirometer. Flow spirometer basically notes the flow which is coming, and it is indicated as when there is flow, so we are able to see the ball. This is our flow spirometer and this is our volume spirometer. In flow spirometer, the rays of the ball shows how much capacity of the patient is increasing, and in volume spirometer, the increasing volume shows how much the patient is recovering. Then is your inspiratory muscle training. Inspiratory muscle training is an addition to our newer techniques. Now the patient is using inspiratory muscle training devices. This is the inspiratory muscle training device. In this device, there is resistance inside the device, and this resistance is adjusted according to the threshold, and when there is small hole, there is more resistance. When there is large hole, there is less resistance. And when the patient try to inspired inside this particular device, the patient is trained for inspiratory muscle training. Then next is airway clearance technique after thoracic surgery. It is only required if the patient have any secretion after thoracic surgeries. If the patient is not having any secretion, so we are not going to go for airway clearance technique. It is going to be assist only when there is secretion after airway surgery. The basic techniques which are included in airway clearance techniques are ACBT, which are used, FET techniques which can be used, and PEEP devices which can be used. Then what is PEEP devices? PEEP devices are positive expiratory devices. They are CPAP, they are PEEP therapies. PEEP therapy, basically there are three type of PEEP devices. Flow resistors are there, then there are threshold resistors, and there are vibratory resistors. In post op phase, in the patient with secretion retention, we are going to use vibratory PEEP devices. And this is the example of vibratory PEEP devices. This is a cupella device, and this is a flutter device, which are basically used. In this patient, start with an upright position, leaning slightly forward, and his and her elbow supported on the table with a mouthpiece that is firmly against his face. The patient is asked to clip the nose, take a long breath, and then expire. He is going to expire in this particular device. And there is a resistance which is set along with it, that is 6 to 25 centimeter of water. and then the patient is given, and then the patient's secretion is cleared because of the vibration which is produced due to this resistance which is applied to this particular device, and due to vibration the secretion is going to mobilize and then it can be removed after with the use of huffing. Then last technique is your intermittent positive pressure breathing. In this breathing, it is basically, there is no proven literature which shows that at intermittent positive pressure breathing is going to benefit the thoracic incision or thoracic surgery patient, but there are some case studies which shows that the good teaching and right patient basically produce effectiveness after post-operative breathing. That means that lung volumes and work of breathing that can be reduced after use of intermittent positive pressure. But we should keep in the mind that in the patient in which there is already a high pressure, we should not use positive pressure breathing. And in which already there is an increase in the residual volume, in that case also we should not use intermittent positive devices. So this is all from my side. Thank you very much. Any questions?
Good evening, Dr. Preeti. A very informative session and a very good explanation of different types of surgeries and different types of incisions, including the role of very important physiotherapists in all of these, and why a physiotherapist must know about different procedures. You have explained very nicely. Dr. Preeti, although the explanations were there, but still there are a few questions as, what happens, because we know that pleura is important to maintain the pressure within the thoracic cavity. So whenever there is pleurectomy, what happens to the pressure changes in the lungs or the thoracic cavity?
Whenever there is pleural surgeries or pleural pressure are basically going to change, because the pressure inside, the basic change in pressure is your transpulmonary pressure. The transpulmonary pressure is going to change as there is any surgery which is going to affect the pleura. And transpleural pressure, when going to affect, there can be retentions inside, there can be atelectasis which is going to happen, there can be other condition which is going, even if there is pressure changes inside the lung, there can be more of the residual load also. So that is the reason I have told that we should perform the exercises in the way that in the patient, if there is already the case of emphysemas, we should not perform the exercises which are going to increase the residual volume furthermore. So that should we should keep in mind, even in the cases of pneumonectomy, we should keep in the mind that if the patient is already undergone pneumonectomy and there are already a load on one of remaining lung, so we should not perform the exercises. That's why I have shown all the things that we should do exercises according to the previous condition, according to the current condition, and assessment of the patient.
Right. Thank you. And the most common thing that we see after thoracic surgeries are chest tubes. So people wanted to know, how do you check chest tube, and what precautions should a physiotherapist take during exercises? And how the procedure should be modified?
Okay, thank you. Chest tube, as I already told you, there should be a swing of the fluid which should always accompany your chest tube, because when there is swing of the movement, that means there is a normal volume of air which is entering and going inside. As in the slide I have shown you also, that when there is inspiration, the fluid goes up, and when there is expiration, the fluid goes down. And whenever there is any kink, or whenever there is any air leak, this swing of the fluid, that means the fluid going up in the inspiration and going down in the expiration, that reduces. So we should always check that this swing of the fluid should always be present. Secondly, we should keep in the mind that the jar or the now the bags are used, that should be always lower than your lung. If it goes up the your lung, then the air can go back inside your cavity and create a problem. So the bag or the tube should always be lower to your chest. The exercises which we can perform with the chest drain is breathing exercises. We can perform by doing that bear hold position, and we can put a firm pressure. We should always check that the tube should not dislodge, and if any such incidents occur, we should go to the emergency, and at same time we should inform a surgeon. At the same time, we should not delay the condition, as it can lead to a serious condition.
Right. And just last two very small questions. One is, can deep breathing exercise be performed in cardiac patients?
Deep breathing exercises can be performed, but without the breath holds. If there is any increase in the pressure already present in cardiac patient, so we should not put the patient on hold. But otherwise, a Valsalva maneuver cannot be there. The Valsalva maneuver should not be performed, but we can do deep breathing exercises without hold in cardiac patients also. No issues.
Okay. And just one more question. And somebody had asked, like, after lobectomy, can the lung regenerate?
No, lung cannot regenerate, but we can use the lung which is available to us as a complete functional lung. We have to focus on the function of the lung that can be recovered after lobectomy. If there will be a good physiotherapy, we can try to improve the volume and capacities. We are not concerned about anatomical structures. There is no regrowth of the lung, but we can use the functionality. We can improve the functionality of the lung as a physiotherapist.
And how important is maintaining posture after thoracic surgeries, or are there abnormalities in posture after thoracic surgery?
Yeah, it is very important to maintain the posture, because the patient has tendency to develop the frozen shoulder, patient has tendency to develop the scoliosis, and there are chances that patient can even have the shortening of the muscles of the side on of the incision. That is the reason we should always try to go for a proper posture, and if we are not able to do so, we can go for splinting of the muscle also.
Okay, thank you so much for this interactive and informative session on thoracic surgery. Thank you for being with us.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, rehab team, for considering me for this session. Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot.